was a strong animal or a strong burden bearer, and he was couching down between two burdens. Well, I'm to be a strong burden bearer, couching down between my burdens, because I have burdens too. And 1 Samuel 10, I'll get it here just a moment, and starting at the 9th verse, and he said, the 6th verse rather, Saul was being called of God, and verse 6 said, and the Spirit of the Lord will come upon thee, and thou shalt prophesy with them, and shall be turned into another man. Now this is after Samuel has anointed him, and the Spirit of the Lord will come upon thee, and thou shalt prophesy with them, and shall be turned into another man. See, that's what God does when you couch down between the two burdens. This is two burdens. What I'm receiving here this afternoon, what I have received for 16 years of my life, 65 years rather, it's become a burden to me. It's changed me. I'm not even the same person I would have been. I've been turned into another man. These 65 years, he has turned me into another man. Completely another man. Because I'm not a member, not even of the Marlowe family anymore. I've been separated from my brothers, natural brothers. They pursued one course, I went another. They gained monetary riches, I gained heavenly riches. They gained fame in the world, I gained nothing in the world, but I gained Christ. I've been turned into another man. See, that's the problem. That's why there's families not sitting here with their children this afternoon, because they could not pay the price. They needed, they could not be turned into another man. They wanted to be the kind of man, the kind of woman that would be accepted in life, and it would be all right if you could somehow nullify the strength of this gospel, so that we didn't teach sanctification, we didn't teach regeneration, we didn't teach separation. Now, then this would be a more popular way to cover.
Yeah.
If we could just leave it to where everything could be a part of it.
Sure.
We could leave it where everybody could be included. See, but that's why band chairs are vacant, because some people love to play an instrument, but they don't want to be turned into another man. They enjoy the popularity of being an accomplished musician or a person able to play an instrument, but they don't want to be turned into another man. That's why the choir is half empty at times, because the singers that God gives good vocal cords to can carry a tune, melody. They don't want to be turned into another man or another woman. That's why preachers fail, is because they'd like to have it where they could not be turned into another man. But God would not let Saul accept the kingship of Israel until he was turned into another man. Issachar was turned into a strong animal, couching down between two burdens. Why did he do that? Because he saw that rest was good. Did you know what will get you over the hump of self-resentment? That God may even called you, that he even spoke to you. He could have left you out, let you frolic in the fields of life, in the pleasure world. Why did he bring me in here? Why did God call me? Why did God let me hear this truth? Why did God ever open my eyes to this understanding of sanctification, regeneration, set apart, giving up, giving over to God? Why? Why did he show me I'm to be a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation? Why? Why did God ever open my eyes to that? To give, to sacrifice, to give up, to give over. Why did God do that to me? because God gave you the promise of eternal life. God promises to turn you in, Brother Steve, here Wednesday night. When he heard this gospel, it first convicted him, it touched him till he wanted to go clean up the trash that he'd dumped on another man's property. I think that's what you said, when it's Steve or something. Some man had that testimony. And then you paid a debt that you owed. But you heard the testimony of a man being willing to give up and go over and clean up the trash he'd dumped that had become a Christian. You see, the gospel does affect you. It will affect you. Once you hear it, you either have to reject it, accept it, or try to go into a neutral mode. And you'll never be in a neutral mode because no man can serve two masters. You can never slip into that mode, but God will never let you be content there. You'll have to choose a master, one master or another, the master of the flesh or the master of the Son of God. And so it said he's going to turn into another man. And let it be, when these signs are come unto thee, that thou do as occasion serve thee. For God is with thee. And thou shalt go down before me to Gilgal, and behold, I will come down unto them to offer burnt offerings and sacrifice of peace offerings. 7 days thou shalt tarry, till I come to thee, and show thee what thou shalt do. Verse 9, and it was so that when he had turned his back to go from Samuel, God gave him another heart. God gave him another heart. See, God does not intend for you to keep the heart that you come to God with. He must give you another heart. He must give me another heart. I cannot keep the heart that I brought to God. The desire, the heart. I can't keep it. I have to give it up. Sooner or later, I've got to let him give me another heart, a new heart, a new spirit. And he gave Saul another heart. And all these things, these signs, came to pass that day. God turned him into another man. He gave him another heart. This is in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, you and I know that we're to be new creations or a new creature. We're not to be the old creature, but if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. See, you somewhere, there has to be a line of demarcation in your life to where you see that you're on the dark side of the cross, on the light side of the cross. Explain that. There were three sides to the cross.
Yes.
Three points. Dark side, inside, and light side. On the dark side, typified by the thief that, or the evil man that railed on Christ, that was the dark side. The rejection, that's the flesh. That's the old nature, that's the Adamic self. That's your old life. That's the dark side. On the other side, with the acceptance of Christ. Lord, remember me. That's the born again. That's the born of the water and of the Spirit. That's the sanctified life. On the other side of the cross, the light side, the paradise side. One side was darkness, the other side was paradise. But in the cross was Christ of twain, two men becoming one man. God making him one man because he was the Son of Man. He was the Son of God on the cross. Jesus could never leave the cross that way. He went to the cross too. He left the cross one because the cross was crucifixion. And the heart of the gospel, the heart of a growing church, the heart of a working church, the heart of an enthused church is in the cross. It's not on the other side where you reject the cross. not on the other side where there's light yet, but you get in the cross. In the cross. That's why 1 Corinthians 1:18, isn't it? Paul said, but the preaching of the cross is to them that perish. Foolishness. But unto us that are saved, it is the wisdom and the power of God. See, never kid yourself. Never pretend that you're going to see the face of God without the cross. Because in the cross, you'll die. But in the cross, you'll live. In the cross, you'll feel rejection, humiliation, everything that Christ felt. How do you think he felt on that cross? Naked, side foot open, thorns nearly 6 inches long, piercing into the skull, going down into the brain, them thrusting vinegar into his mouth, his mother down there never to recognize her again, his disciples far from him. But in that cross, he finally said, he didn't say it in the beginning, but he said, it is finished. You only get to the light side of the cross, the resurrection, and eternal life with God, when you go from the dark side in the cross and you're crucified with Christ. There is no skipping it. There is no going around it. Anyone that ever hears the truth, like I said, they may go 1,000 miles from it. They may say, I'll find an easier way. They will never, never get around the judgment seat. Because the judgment seat is the church in the city. When God sets up the church in the city, he sets the judgment seat up. And we all appear before that judgment seat to receive of the things done in our body, whether it be good or bad, whether it be evil or righteousness, because that is the judgment seat. That's what Peter was talking about. Help me with this. 1 Peter 4:17. But the time has come but the time has come when judgment must begin. Where does it begin? At the house of God. Did you know God doesn't have to judge the ungodly? Did you know the ungodly have been judged since eternity? He doesn't judge them. There's one thing for them, that's death. You don't have to measure out, let's see, is this righteousness or death? It's death. Romans 6:23 said the wages of sin is death. That settles it, doesn't it? The ungodly, God doesn't have to judge them. They're not so. Psalms 1, read Psalms 1. Get an understanding of the first chapter of Psalms. Blessed is the man, walketh not in the counsel of the ungodliness, and the way of the sinner, to sin, to see the scorn, but his light is in the law of the Lord, and that law does he meditate both day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the river of the water of life, bringing forth his fruit in the season, his leaf falls through, shall not wither. See, but the ungodly are not so. The ungodly are not so. They're like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Life to death. Put them in the ground, walk away from them, they're dead. Body, soul, spirit, they'll never come forth from the grave. How much you want them to come forth, they are the dead. Free among the dead. Free among the dead. Psalms 88, isn't it? Free among the dead. You're like the slain which lie in the grave. Free among the dead. Whom thou rememberest no more. There's no remembrance. Psalm 6:5 says, for in death there is no remembrance of thee. And in the grave, who shall give thee thanks? There is no remembrance in that grave. Ecclesiastes, the 3rd chapter, said, there's no wisdom, there's no work in the grave. Man dieth as a beast dies, so dieth one, so dieth the other. Man hath no preeminence over the beast. I'm giving you some truth here. And I want you to get this, because how much of the Word of God you get, how much you understand. And brother, I've never seen anybody attend a university one day and graduate. I've never seen anybody attend any school of learning anywhere piecemeal. Get fragments of it. I'll get a lesson now, 6 months I'll get another one. You'll never graduate. You'll never matriculate. You can't do the Word of God that way. It's continuously learning. It's continuously hearing. Yes, is there a price to pay? There is. There is. Is there labor? There is. But Issachar saw that the rest was good. Am I in labor now? I sure am. Brother Marlowe, do you have a lot of relaxation time? Not much. What do you do with 7 days? I give it as much as I can to God. And if I worked on an insurance job one time, I gave all I could to God. I worked a job, J.C. Penney, worked there. I gave as much as I could to God. Leave the job, Sister Marlowe would meet me. J.C. Penney worked downtown in a department store down there, menswear. And as soon as they let me out that door, she'd have me a sandwich fixed. We'd get in a car and drive 135 miles to conduct a service in Cloiston, Florida, when I first come here. Never see the house till 2 o'clock in the morning. Well, why'd you do that? Because I found the judgment seat. Because God's going to judge me. I must give an account of my life. Were you hungry? Yes. Were you tired? Yes. Tired coming back from Sebring Friday night. Asked Brother Rosellis. He said, Brother Marlowe, you stopped right in the middle of the road almost. And he was behind me. And I was tired. I was grieving a little bit, wasn't I? He come up alongside me and see if I was all right. Why do you do that? Because, see, I'm before the judgment seat.
Hallelujah.
I'm before the judgment seat. God's judging my attitude, my action, my feeling, my desires, what I want to do in this life. I'm in school. I'm studying. Oh, that I had the privilege to take some of you young men. Chris down there, Ryan, Johnny back here. All you young men sitting before me. Put in your mind the desire to study the scriptures.
Amen.
The desire to help God's people. The desire to help the church.
Amen.
Oh, that you men that have been called in the ministry. Brother Tom back there is called into the ministry. And you men sitting back here around me. Oh, how I revel. How I rejoice. How I stand on my feet. When one of you get up and the Holy Ghost connects you. And the Holy Ghost ministers through you. Because I want to see you fulfill the purpose and plan of God. When I see you sisters, anointed of God, help of God, touched of God, and I see you doing the work of God, what it does to me. Because I realize that somebody is getting this message. Somebody is putting it into practice. Somebody is understanding it. And somebody is going to graduate and finish their course. And they're going to have eternal life. That's the rest. Are you tired now? Yes, I am. Yes, I am. You will be too. If you get under the burden of the local church, if you carry the burden of this local church, if you get under the burden of it, you couch down between these two burdens here of the old and the new covenant, you'll find a place of labor. You'll find something to do. Your hands will not be idle. You'll be a prayer warrior. You'll be a student. You'll be a carpenter, you'll be a painter, you'll be a floor sweeper, you'll be a healer of wounds. You'll do something because God will assign you, put you in a place because you are an Issachar. You're a worker. And you'll find a job. You'll find something to do because the Lord won't let you rest. Because your rest is not now, your labor is now. Your labor's now. That's, you see, somebody said, I'm just going to come to the church and rest. You're wrong. You're not in your period of rest right now. Your rest remaineth. Yet there remaineth therefore a rest. Let's go to Hebrews 4. And you can stop and ask a question as I go through this lesson if you want to. If I stir your mind the right way or the wrong way, you can ask me a question. Hebrews 4, there's two ways you stir your mind. There's two ways you stir your mind, the right way or the wrong way. I've had my mind stirred both ways.
Yes, sir.
So I understand when my mind is stirred the right way, I understand when it's stirred the wrong way. But it's any way it's stirred. I'd rather see a man stirred right or wrong than to be in a neutral mood. Because he'll at least try to find the truth. In Hebrews 4, verse 1, he said, "Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it." I see. So the promise is of rest. Come unto me. Matthew 11, 28, 29. "But come unto me, all of you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Sounds wonderful, doesn't it? Come unto me. Sweetest time you ever have in your life is when a minister gives an altar call and Christ touches your heart and you come to the Lord. You're so in love with Jesus that moment. Heaven is beautiful. God is beautiful. Saints are beautiful. You don't see a thing, know a thing. You don't hear a thing. You're not going through any fire. Fire baptism hasn't come yet. You're just coming to the Lord.
Yes.
What a beautiful moment that is.
Yes, it is.
What a beautiful moment that is. Enjoy it.